CSIs were combing the beach, Connelly and I were interviewing the people who ran the tournament, looking for any enemies or people who might want to target them in this tournament in particular, but those led nowhere. Sadly, the CSIs fared no better. The entire crime scene was awash. There were so many footprints and shoe and sandal prints in the sand, it was impossible to search for tracks, and the actual razor blades and pieces of wood had been doused in bleach before being placed in their small dugouts. There were no security cameras on the beach, and the lone one that was in the parking lot didn't capture any cars between the hours of midnight and 7 a.m. Our phones were ringing off the hook with tips that were no real leads. After a month, we were nowhere in the investigation. Then a new investigation came in, and our hamstrung department got even tighter. Connelly and I took it on as well. At a senior's home, along the city's waterfront, a fire had started in the basement. Because of the accelerants used, it quickly overtook the first two floors. From there, the rest of the 8-story building went up. 22 residents and 9 staff died in the fire, all from smoke inhalation. We scoured the undamaged security footage, but again found no suspects around the parking lots or front entrances. The footage from the rear of the building was destroyed, so we couldn't check it. Then a third investigation dropped onto our desks. This time there was a mass poisoning in a junior high school cafeteria. There were 23 deaths, 15 of which were students, and over 100 severe injuries. Our investigation showed that someone had stealthily broken into the school overnight and poisoned every piece of food in the cafeteria stockroom, fridge, and freezer with arsenic. It was a miracle more people didn't die. All the school's exterior cameras were working, and after scouring them for clues, we finally found one at the back doors. The footage captured someone dressed in all black, with a hood and ski mask over his face. He'd used a small set of lockpicking tools to enter the back door, which led to the kitchen. He used the same door to exit and ran off across the soccer field, towards the water. And everything made sense. The beach volleyball courts, the senior's home, and now this junior high. They all backed out onto the water. The school itself had taken advantage of that fact by introducing students to rowing, kayaking, sailing, swimming, and other sports and activities on the open sea. And the senior's home was partially marketed based on its incredible view of the water. We hypothesized the three mass crimes were committed by the same individual. We marked all three locations on a map and scanned down the coast for all the marinas and harbors. Then we went back through all the routes and picked out various waterfront hotspots we knew would have footage of their exteriors. Using the dates of the three incidents, we cross-checked the footage to try to find any repeat boats on the nights in question. We watched a lot of footage. There was only one boat that stood out, a large, older black speedboat being driven by a lone individual we couldn't make out details of. A red light glowed from inside the cabin. Connelly and I got pictures of the boat printed and went back to check the marinas and harbours. None of the docks we went to had seen the particular boat or had records of it, which made us think it was docking at a private residence. I spoke to one of my friends in narcotics named Wacko, and he brought up the drug boats that had been populating the cove near the last dock we visited. It turned out that the many drug users in our city had been moving away from the alleyways and SROs and onto small dinghies and drug boats, turning them into floating pill houses. The boats were harder for cops to break up or investigate, and you could float in the cove or out in the nearby channel for up to 6 months before having to vacate. Of course, the 6-month rule was never enforced, so the cove kept getting busier with more and more drug boats. Wacko offered to help. He went in one night and made his way around the 30 or so boats, which were loosely tied together. Wacko found our black boat. He learned the owner was a guy people called Red. He was a dealer and let people use and pass out on board his boat afterwards. The next night, Wacko went back and
mask was different, but followed the typical design of a face with eyes, nose, and mouth.
Everything sounded like it was underwater, but was moving really fast. I managed to turn my head and saw the one remaining band member, the one holding the baby. He'd placed it on the ground at the center of the pentagram. He grabbed the sledgehammer from his dead friend and lifted it to slam down on the remaining baby. I didn't even realize it, but I still had my 9mm in my hand. Reflexively, I pulled the trigger repeatedly until it clicked empty. The final shot connected with the guy's head as he was about to swing down. He toppled back and the sledgehammer fell safely to the side. I don't remember much else after that. I woke up in the hospital and was informed Connolly had died, as had all the band members. The baby and the young woman had survived though, so there was that. The investigation was taken over by two other detectives and revealed that the band had been taking women from shows, bringing them back to the farmhouse and trying to impregnate them. Once they had gotten 6 pregnant, they planned a mass ritual sacrifice to be conducted after the final birth as an offering to the devil in some Faustian bargain. The other women had been killed after their deliveries and were buried in the far end of the basement. I never saw any of the band members' eyes when they were alive because of the masks, though I'm sure if I did, they'd carry the same darkness as Patty's and Red's. I said I'd seen true evil 3 times in my career, and that's true. But that last time, there was more to what happened than what I put in my reports. It's the reason I retired immediately after the case. It's the thing that made me realize there was an evil I couldn't even begin to comprehend. I'd seen it right when I got into the basement and leveled off my 9mm at the 3 men. There was something else down there with us. It was floating in the middle of the circle, kind of like black smoke, but it stayed in place, wafting together before separating and reconnecting. Bolts of red electricity shot through it. The smoke got larger as the chanting grew. It pulsed and expanded and reached out, forming into the shape of a body. What gives me nightmares now?